Good evening, new prospect. Welcome to Wednesday night prayer and Bible study. We want to thank you guys so much for tuning in. If you are a guest or visitor for the very first time, we want to welcome you as well. Thank you for sharing your evening with us as we worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We would love to share more information with you about who we are, what we do, and what we believe. Maybe you find yourself asking that question right now. Please go check us out on our website as well as our Facebook page. You can gain a great deal of information about our family of faith there. But if you still have questions, please reach out. We would love to answer those for you and share with you next steps on how you can get involved with our family of faith here. Thank you guys again so much for being here. Before we jump into Bible study tonight, we do want to open it up for a time of prayer. Perhaps you have a prayer request that's laying on your heart. You would like us to be lifting that up on your behalf. We would love to do that. You can simply respond to the Facebook feed here, or you can reach out another way. Let us know about it. We would love to be lifting that concern up in prayer. At this time, let's go ahead and take a look at tonight's prayer list. So please take note of the additions to our prayer list. You'll see we've added the name of Mr. Zach Davis and Mr. Raymond Bell to Lynchburg General Hospital. Please remember these folks this week. We also have our members at home that we want to continue to lift up in prayer. Under family and friends, we have added the name of Mr. Mark Crouch this week. He is a friend of Terrell Peak. Let's remember him. And we're expressing sincere Christian sympathy to the families of Mr. Ronald Clay, Mr. David Eckert, Mrs. Pam Shelton Lance, and Mr. Charles Rader. Please remember these families as they grieve the loss of a loved one this week. Our homebound of the week is Mr. Bill Law, and our student of the week is Ian Garner. Let's shower them with love this week. Lift them up in prayer. Let them know that we are thinking and care for them greatly. As you see there, also remember those on our at-home list and those in autumn care and in other assisted living facilities throughout our area. If you would, bow with me in a moment of prayer as we lift up these concerns. Lord, we come to you today and we thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to gather together and lift the concerns of our hearts. Lord, we know the importance of this. Lord, we know that you know each and every need. Lord, you know them by name. And so, Lord, we just lift them to you tonight. Lord, we pray for your healing hand. We pray for your comforting arm. And, Lord, we pray for your guidance and direction in their lives. Lord, whatever it is that they are experiencing, Lord, we know that you're greater and that you are all-powerful. Lord, perfectly capable of handling what's going on. And so, Lord, we give that to you tonight. And, Lord, we just pray that all these folks would feel your presence. Lord, that they would know you're there. That they would know that you care. You love them greatly. Lord, as we dive into your word, Lord, we pray that you would just use it to sharpen us in our faith, Lord. That you would present us with opportunities to be your hands and feet. Lord, we praise you. We thank you. We love you. And we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Good evening. It's good to once again be with you by way of the magic of the internet and to join in a Bible study of the book of James. It's been about 4 weeks since we've gathered for the study in this way. Hope that you had a wonderful end of Advent and have made your way through not only Christmas Day, but the Christmas season. If you're watching this on Wednesday, January the 5th, then it's still okay for you to say Merry Christmas, because this is the last day of the Christmas season. It is the 12th day of Christmas, and I cannot remember what you're supposed to give on the 12th day of Christmas, but maybe you have it at hand. Tomorrow actually begins the season of Epiphany. And just reading back on that season, it's actually an older season that was observed by the Christians back in the first through fourth century. And actually part of Epiphany would have been Christmas at that time. But anyway, just to give you a little backdrop to that season. And so if you want to, you can get out your Bible, read Matthew, where the wise men come. That is a part of the season of Epiphany. But this evening, we're going to look at James chapter 5, verses 7 through 11. It shouldn't take us long, but I hope it will be interesting and informative, and we'll gain much from it. So I hope you have your Bibles ready and open, and let's read our text for this evening. Beginning with verse 7, "Therefore, brothers, be patient until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth and is patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts because the Lord's coming is near. Brothers, do not complain about one another so that you will not be judged. Look, the judge stands at the door. Brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the Lord's name as an example of suffering and patience. See, we count as blessed those who have endured. You have heard of Job's endurance and have seen the outcome from the Lord. The Lord is very compassionate and merciful." Let us pray. Father, we pray as we study this portion of your word that indeed you would enlighten us through the presence of your Spirit, and that it would guide us into some level of understanding of what it is you're trying to say to us through this portion of the book of James. We ask, God, that once we have been blessed by it, that we would in turn be a blessing to others. For we offer this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. "Therefore, brothers, be patient until the Lord's coming." Whenever you see the word "therefore" in Scripture, you know that what is taking place is that somehow the writer is relating what he's about to write to what he has previously written. So if you are right there in verse 7 and you read "therefore," you ask yourself, well, what did he write before verse 7? And if you read the previous paragraph, at least in the Holman Christian Study Bible, what you discover is that James has been issuing a warning to the wicked rich. And he's not necessarily saying the wealthy are evil in and of themselves, but there in that day there was unfortunately those people who used their wealth to really just use power over other people, and to not see people as being valuable to them because they are just people, but just see people as a commodity, and so they would treat them in a horrible way. So he's saying, "Therefore, brothers, be patient." In other words, in the face of all this that you've been experiencing because of the heavy-handedness of very wealthy, wicked people, be patient until the Lord's coming, because when the Lord's come, he's the rightful judge, and as the rightful judge, he will settle accounts. And if those wicked, wealthy people have been filling their blessed in this life, in this age, well, there's an age to come where they will get their just due, and you will get your just due. Be patient until the Lord's coming. Now, I don't know about you, it's hard to be patient anymore. I mean, maybe we should have learned through this experience of COVID a little bit about patience. I know this past week, my wife Ruth and I went to Lynchburg. We went there to do some shopping for household items, and we decided to eat at a restaurant. And we went in there, it was Cracker Barrel, and typically, you know, you have a lot of people gathered there. Well, the parking lot, this was about 3:30. Parking lot was about only a third full. We walk into the restaurant, the entry, and if you've ever been there, you know they've got a little shop where you can buy items, candy and clothes and items like that. And then they have a little area where you go up and you wait to place, get your table and your time. So when we walked into there, there wasn't anybody shopping, looking around at the items there. We looked up and there was maybe three people standing near where you're waiting to be seated. And so Ruth and I walked up there, and she approached the young lady there taking, getting your seating and everything like that. And she said, how many will it be? And Ruth said, two. And so Ruth asked, well, how long will it be before we're seated and can eat? And she said, 45 minutes. She said, we're low on staff. And so Ruth and I proceeded to walk out. We didn't stay. We did not want to wait 45 minutes to eat. You know, we hadn't had lunch. We had had a little bit of a late breakfast, and we were hungry. We said, we want to eat. We were not patient in that instance for our service and our food. Now, as we look at this, we're thinking about being patient in our text for today. Imagine if somebody gave you, you're waiting for something, and you have no time estimate for when it will occur. Wonder if instead of waiting 45 minutes for something, you had been waiting 45 years. And suddenly, you're reading from the book of James, or this letter of James, and James is telling you, therefore, brothers, be patient until the Lord's coming, and you say to yourself, but we've already been waiting this long. When's he going to come? And we realize that oftentimes God is patient with us. In other words, he's long-suffering. He is waiting for us to come to him. But we sometimes are impatient for God to come to us. James is urging these Christians in that first century setting to consciously embrace the practice of patience. And it's interesting, if you look through this, James is a very fast, and remember this is almost like a sermon, he's a fascinating preacher here. And one of the things he immediately does as he gives this exhortation is he gives an example of what this would look like to practice patience. And the first example he gives is from agriculture. He says, look at the farmers and see how he waits for produce from his fields. And he speaks of two rains, the early and the late rains. Now, you have to remember that he is talking to people or writing to people who live in Israel or that area of the world. And in that climate, what you discover is the early rains typically came in late October or early November. And then the late rains would fall in April or May. And when the early rains came, it was time for you to do your planting. And when the late rains were coming, it was time for you to do your harvesting. Now, the reality is this. The farmer cannot push the rains. And therefore, he cannot demand the time when he will be doing his harvesting. He has to wait patiently. He does sow the seed. He plows the field and sows the seed, prepares it. And he does it in this time when the early rains come. But he has to wait patiently for those latter rains to fall. And so James exhorts Christians, you also must be patient. He says, just like as the farmer is waiting for the harvest of his produce, so you must wait for Christ to come. And it's that word that is being used there is the word, you know, about the second coming of Jesus. So you sowed the seed early, you harvested it late. Now, we are already into a new year, 2022, but it really hasn't been that long since we celebrated or observed Thanksgiving. And I don't know about you, but one of the songs that we typically sing at Thanksgiving is Come Ye Thankful People Come. Have you ever really looked at the words of that song? The words were written in like 1844, so quite a long time ago, almost 200 years. But if you look at the stanzas of that song, what you will discover is that the first one speaks about being thankful for what God has given to us through our harvest. In other words, for the blessings of the food that has been produced from our hands and our work and everything else like that. But the final stanzas, the final three, are not about that, but about God's harvest of us. The final one reads this way: Even so, Lord, quickly come, bring thy final harvest home. Gather thou thy people in, free from sorrow, free from sin. There forever purified, in thy garner to abide. Come with all thine angels, come, raise the glorious harvest home. So here we are in this thing, and he's talking to us. These people are waiting. Even so, Lord, quickly come. Written about 1700 years after James writes. James is writing to people waiting for the harvest to come, for God to come in Christ, the triumphant return. 1700 years later, the writer of Come Ye Thankful People Come was writing to people anxiously awaiting God's harvest to come. 200 years almost later, we are doing the same. And yet, even as we wait, we look at what he says in verse 8. You also must be patient. But how? Strengthen your hearts, because the Lord's coming is near. Strengthen your hearts. The word is sterizo in the Greek. Same word sort of used back in Luke 22:32, when Jesus is talking to Peter and he says, But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And you, when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. Peter's not the only one who strengthens. In 1 Peter 5:10, Peter writes, Now the God of all grace, who called you to this eternal glory in Christ Jesus, will personally restore, establish, strengthen, and support you after you have suffered a little. So it is sort of suggesting here that the job of us, as we wait patiently, is to strengthen one another and for God to strengthen us as well. For the Lord's coming is soon. It's the Greek word parousia, some people pronounce it parousia. But it's interesting that word has been transliterated over into the English language. Now, if you go back to the first century, that word was used to declare the arrival of kings or highly esteemed persons. But Christians took up that word and they began to apply it specifically to the return of Jesus. Now, so that's what we're supposed to do. As we wait patiently, let us strengthen one another, because the Lord's coming is near. We might not feel like it, but this is what he writes. And then in verse 9, brothers, do not complain with one another so that you will not be judged. Look, the judge stands at the door. Once again, a reference to Christ being there right at the door. Now, what is the tendency of most people when things aren't working out well for them, when things aren't pleasing them? It's to find someone to complain about. And you always want to blame others for the distress that you're feeling at the present moment. That Greek word that is used there for complain, maybe it was translated as groaning in your translation. That's what it means, to not so. Groaning. And it's interesting that in some instance, James is saying, if you're judging others by your complaints, by your groaning, guess what? The true judge is going to judge you. And so we can choose one or two paths as brothers and sisters in Christ, as members of a church family. We can choose, one, to complain against one another, where we're in essence breaking each other apart or breaking apart from each other. Or we can choose the strengthening of one another, where we're bringing each other together, where we're building each other up, even as we patiently wait. Which one do you think Jesus would prefer us to do? We know which one that James is suggesting. Right here, it becomes very, very clear. Once again, as a good preacher, James starts to give us examples. Brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the Lord's name as an example of suffering and patience. Remember what I told you about when we read where James says, therefore, he's referring to the way the wicked are treating the poor and everything. The wicked wealthy are treating the poor. So he's talking to people, he's writing to people who are suffering. And he is seeking to encourage them as they're encountering all these difficulties in their lives, maybe much like we have done it, you know, through the past 2 years especially, trying to encourage people. And so in his encouragement, what he does, he points people back to their past, to not their personal past, but to the past of their people. And he says, you look back there, and you remember those prophets? They should be your example because they suffered patiently. The writer of the book of Hebrews does much the same in chapter 11, verses 37 through 38. They were stoned, they were sawed in two, they died by the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, afflicted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts, mountains, caves, and holes in the ground. That wonderful word that is used there when he's saying, as an example, literally means copy to be imitated. So he's saying, imitate the prophets. You know the stories of the prophets. You know the stories of Elijah and Elisha. You know the story of Isaiah. Remember what they went through. Remember what Jeremiah went through. Remember the suffering they encountered and how they remained faithful to God in all of their suffering. He goes on to write in verse 11, see, we count as blessed those who have endured. And then he uses another example of endurance. Remember, he's talked about the prophets in enduring. Now he says, you have heard of Job's endurance and have seen the outcome from the Lord. The Lord is very compassionate and merciful. We count as blessed. He's saying, if we count that as being a blessing, then as we think about that, then we should know that we are being blessed as we endure as well. This is the only mention of Job in the New Testament. Notice James refers to Job's endurance rather than his patience. Some people say he was patient, but if you go back and you really read the book of Job, what you discover is Job was oftentimes like us, that when things didn't go his way, of course he became very impatient. But he remained faithful. He remained faithful. And in the end, because of his faithfulness, what Job experienced was God's compassion and mercy. And this is the outcome of the life of faith. The issue when we face suffering is to not lose faith. Now, I want to tell you something about that word endurance. It is not a passive patience that it's talking about. I love the way William Barclay describes it. He describes it as that gallant spirit which can breast the tides of doubt and sorrows and disaster and come out with faith still stronger on the other side. And this is what you see in the life of Job. If you want to see how Job was really blessed, we typically go back and we read and we say, oh, well, God gave him back more than he had lost. You know, he gave him back more wealth, more possessions. He even restored a family to him. You know, of course, you can't replace children. But anyway, he said all those things he was blessed more. But the real blessing that Job received after he went through his trials was that he understood God a little bit better. He had a clearer picture of God and how God related to the world that he created and the people that he had created. And so that's really the story there. So here's James, and he's calling us to patience, to wait. But he's telling us to strengthen one another and not to complain against one another, but to consider the example of faithful people in the past who faithfully endured suffering and who probably in the end found themselves being blessed by God. And I hope that maybe you know of people that way as well. I know in my own studies, I have some what we might call modern martyrs who remain faithful to the end, and what a blessing their example has been to me. And maybe, who knows, maybe God, because God is gracious and he always calls people in every place and every time to be his people and to be an example to other folks, maybe God will use you as an example to someone else of what it means to faithfully endure. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the book of James and for allowing us together to study it. Lord, we live in a difficult time as well. It seems, God, that all around us, the numbers still hit by the pandemic are climbing. We hope maybe in 2022 we'll come to the end of it. But even as we patiently wait, Lord, we pray that you would strengthen us and that you would have us strengthen one another, and that because you are gracious to us, that you would instill your spirit in us in such a way that we would be a body of believers, Lord, who understand what you have called us to be and do. We pray, God, that we would indeed endure in our faith and grow in our faith, and that our suffering, Lord, would not turn us away from you, but turn us towards you. And that in the end, as we get to the end of it, or as we even make our way through it, what we will discover is because you do love us and you are gracious towards us, that even in our pain and our suffering, you're blessing us. So guide us, God, we pray, throughout this coming new year, this new year that we're in, 2022, even as we come to the end of the Christmas season and head our way into Epiphany, help us show Jesus to other people. For it's in his name that we pray. Amen. And I pray God would bless you through the rest of this year, and that hopefully you will be joining us each Wednesday night when we're here and we're presenting it to delve into the study of God's Word. And we still have a little bit left of the book of James, so I invite you to be back with me next week. God's blessings upon you all. See you next week.